Welcome everybody to the April 3rd PhillyPosh meeting. Tonight we're really glad to have Ashley McGlone, Premier Field Engineer, also known as Goatee PFE, join us to give a pretty interesting talk, I think. Ashley, I'll let you describe it if you want to go ahead and jump in and do that. I'll turn it over to you.
All right, so how many folks do I have in the room there?
2, 4, 6, 8, 9 of us.
Okay, great. And what's everybody's background as far as PowerShell? Who's kind of beginner, intermediate, advanced? What do you think the population is?
We'll do a raise of hands for beginners. So we got four beginners.
All right.
And, intermediate, advanced. Ryan's also a beginner.
Yeah. All right, so we got a mixed group. Fine. So I think there's going to be something for everybody in this session tonight. Those of you who are new to PowerShell are going to like this because I think it's going to really help you get past that first hurdle of what do I do once I click that blue window and it comes up? What's next? And kind of going through the process of what is inside the scripter's head. What is he thinking when he's sitting there trying to write a script? So that's what we're going to cover. And I titled this Demystifying the PowerShell Scripting Process. And then when we're done, I'll tell you where to get a copy of the slides and scripts. So you can have those to reference later. So let's see. Let me get back to the beginning of my deck. There we go. Lao Tzu in the 4th century BC, pretty famous for this quote. You probably have heard it before. Give a man a script, feed him for a get date. Teach a man a script, feed him for a new dash time span. Have you ever heard that quote before?
That's the original hit card.
So basically this session is about teaching you how to fish, teaching you how to script for yourself. And like I said, you know, you click the blue PowerShell window and you're just like, what now? Okay, how do I get started here? So we're going to kind of go from there, but then we're going to kind of pick it up and talk about the whole scripting process in general. And the thoughts that I'm going to share with you this evening are mostly my own. There have been several folks that have written books on development cycles. Several PowerShell people even have written those types of books, and I haven't read any of them. This is all based on my own experience personally, and you'll find that it lines up pretty well with what the other folks in the development and PowerShell community would say in those books that they've written as well. So we're going to look at, you know, how to script for ourselves. Figure out how to. What's that?
I think we lost your screen there.
Uh-oh. That's not good. Let me share it out again. It says it didn't start again. Try it again here. The link is not happy. Tell you what, let me jump out of the link session and you guys eat some pizza and let me jump right back in and see if we can get a better connection. Hold on, I'll be right back.
Say that again, what was?
So, there's a preview release, Windows Management Framework 5. And with OneGet is a new way to discover and install software packages from around the web.
There we go.
And
you make me a presenter again.
Oh, come on, there we go. Okay.
All right, let me know when you can see the screen.
What am I going to do? What? Okay.
All right. So the objectives of this session is to move from copy and paste scripting to I can do this scripting. All right. Because a lot of us start out, we're just doing a search online. We find some script that's close enough to what we want to do. We copy and paste. We get it going. We edit it. And, and that's how most of us get our start. And what we want to do is kind of move from that stage to getting some confidence around your own scripting abilities. So that's what we're going to talk about tonight. And the first question is, why script? I know this is kind of a fundamental question, but let's kind of step back for a second and think about it. Why do we write scripts? I'm curious what your feedback is from those in the room or online.
Automate something.
Automate some sort of process, right?
Okay. Automation, what else?
To do something faster.
Definitely. Bjorn says consistency. All right. Those are all good answers. None of them are wrong. There's lots of things that we can do with scripts. Here are some that I came up with. It's repeatable. So if it takes me a half an hour to do it by hand, and I decide instead to take a half an hour and write a script to do it, I've broken even on the first iteration. But if I have to go back and do that again in test or production or stage environments, all of a sudden now it's repeatable and I can see that half hour every time I run the script. So repeatable is a big deal. It also eliminates human error. You know, if I've got to update DNS server addresses on 50 servers, there's a really good chance I'm probably going to mistype one of those IPs. And so it eliminates that opportunity for human error. Unless, of course, you are the error writing the script, and then you're at a real problem, right? But for the most part, it's going to eliminate human error. Change control logging. This is something Ed mentioned to me one time when we were at Tech Ready talking, and he said, you know, when you write a script, you automatically have a change control plan that you can submit. Say, here's exactly what we're going to do, and if something didn't work, well, it had to be in this script. So you can see the exact steps for your implementation plan right there in your script. Huge time savings, like we talked about already. Job satisfaction. You know, there's something in our nature that makes us want to play with Legos. We just like to build stuff. And when you're writing a script, it's really satisfying to say, wow, I feel like I really got something done today. This script is now going to run every night on a scheduled task and update these 200 servers and send out reports and things like that. So now I really have some satisfaction in that. And finally, it's job security, because it's really getting to the point where if you don't know PowerShell, you're at a significant disadvantage in the job market. And if you're that go-to scripter on your team, that's good for you in the long term for your career. So let's talk about the process then. The overall process of scripting kind of follows this little flow in the world of PowerShell, at least. It all starts out with an idea, some need, and then we go find some commandlets. We find some commandlets to get the data that we need to meet that need or create that report, whatever it is we're doing. And then we take those commandlets and we string them together into a pipeline. We take those and we copy and paste them into a script, and then we take those scripts and build them out into functions and modules. And after you've done that a few times and begin to get that reputation on your team at work, then you become the PowerShell hero. So what we want to do is talk through each one of these phases a little bit to kind of to get your juices going on what kind of things we can talk about with scripting. And the first thing is the idea. You've got a need, something that has to get done. And anytime you're sitting there thinking to yourself, there's got to be a better way, or there's just too much clicking involved, then really PowerShell is your answer. You know, when you're thinking, like I said earlier, if you got to update DNS configurations on 50 servers, you really don't want to do that by hand. You want to automate that. I had a customer situation one time where we needed to fix Active Directory sites and site length. And they had about 400 sites that they wanted consolidated. They were what we called empty sites. They didn't have any domain controllers in them. They wanted to re-architect their site structure, essentially, and their site links. And I sat down and wrote a script in a few minutes that was able to do it for us instead of sitting there and clicking in the interface for days where it's just not practical. So we can automate a lot of things that really help. Now, what I recommend to a lot of people is find your top five help desk issue resolutions. So those things that get escalated to your team or to you and you need to go fix them, you know, if it's automation, you know, friendly, something like just restarting a service or, you know, resetting a web app or something like that, something where there might be a few steps involved, even if you just need to maybe copy over a file or rename something and then restart a service, something that's maybe a top resolution item for you. And you can automate those and then give those scripts to the help desk and give them a parameter, let's say just prompts them for a server name or something, and they can run that solution script and really automate and save you time and save them time. Server build process, validation, those are always great things for scripting out, you know, what you're going to do with the configuration and things like that as you're building out your servers. And then your check script. So depending on the nature of your company, some companies have architects and then implementers. And so if you're one of the ops guys that builds the servers, you can run the validation script to make sure nothing was missed and even configure it after the fact. I always talk about monthly inventory reporting because this is a big one. You know, you can figure out, let's say you've got to do the popular disk space report or SQL databases or mailbox sizes, and you've got some kind of regular report that you run on a weekly, monthly, quarterly basis. You can script the whole thing out and then schedule a task that runs the report, emails it as an attachment, and it makes you look like you're being really productive, you know, while you're home gaming or something else, something more important. So you can also calculate the number of days to talk like a pirate day. There's just nothing you can't do with PowerShell. September 19th, any talk like a pirate day fans out there?
Everybody.
Anybody know what I'm talking about?
I'm aware, yeah. Yeah, we got one.
Okay.
Two, three.
All right. Couple pirate people. Okay. Pirates are better than ninjas. Okay. So next up, let's talk about the next phase. So we've got our scripting idea. Now we've got to put some bones on it. We've got to find some commandlets. And we're going to kind of go through and demo some of these things. So the next piece is, I've got this big scripting idea. How do I get started? And really that boils down to, how do I get the commands that I need? Where did I find that data? And we've got some commandlets to help with that. Get help, get command, get member is on there as well. But then in version 3, we added a new commandlet, show command, that's really fancy. We're going to take a look at that as well. So we can use these commands to actually dive in, find the commandlets, find the parameters that we need, the properties that we need to report on. And that gets us started in finding where that data lives, either in WMI or SIM, or collecting information from the registry, the event log, whatever type of data we need. And so then we can use getSIM class, for example, to find a list of all of the WMI namespaces, where all of our PC information lives, all of our server information, all those details that we inventory through SCCM and products like that. You know, instead of bugging the SCCM guy, we can write our own little report and go grab it pretty quickly without having to wait. So we're going to take a look at these things here in a few minutes once we get into the demos. So that's the next step, is then once I've got my idea, and then I want to go and find out what commandlets can get me the data to begin working with that idea. Bjorn's online. He says he loves getSIM class, especially with the property name, instead of having to search for the internet. And I agree, Bjorn, that is a big deal, because back in the VB script days, you had to search MSDN for everything you wanted to do. But nowadays, we have so many options right out of the box that it makes it even easier. So what happens next is probably one of my favorite parts. Next, once we've got these commands, then we string them together into pipelines. So the output from the left becomes input to the right. And here's an example at the bottom with get service. And I want to filter that where the status is running, and then sort it by name, and then pipe it out to a grid view. And when you pipe all those things together with that little vertical bar, that strings them together into one line of code. And that's what's so amazing about PowerShell. I can do all of those things with one line of code. I mean, back in the day with VBScript, I can't even imagine how many lines it would take just to get a list of services, probably from WMI, and then to sort out just the ones you wanted, sort them by name, and then pop them into a GUI. That would be a crazy amount of VBScript to do that. Now we can do it in one line of PowerShell. So that's what's really exciting for me about PowerShell, is the fact that it's one line of code a lot of times. And you don't have to set everything to a variable. A lot of us, how many VBScripters do we have? Anybody that used to do VBScript in the room or online?
Everybody.
Everybody? All right. Yeah, and so we used to assign things to variables, and then we would work with those variables, and that was kind of the way you did things in VBScript. But in PowerShell, you know, this one line here, get service, where status is running, sort it by the name, and pipe it to an outgrid view. You know, back in VBScript, you'd have all kinds of variables involved trying to get that list of services and grabbing those into an array, and then kind of iterating through that array, checking for where the status would be running, and then you have to write a whole bubble sort routine to do the sort. I mean, it's just crazy. And you're assigning all these variables everywhere, but here in PowerShell, we really don't have to do that. We can just pipe one thing to the next, and we don't have to use variables as much as we used to either. This next example here, just simply getting a list of servers from a text file, a really common example. And then for each one of those, we want to get a list of hotfixes on there, and then export that whole list to a CSV file. That is just crazy easy, you know, compared to what it used to be years ago. Now, in the help topics, there's an about underscore pipelines topic, then you can type that exactly into your PowerShell console, get help about underscore pipelines, and it'll give you lots of extra information about how those work. Any questions so far?
Nope.
Okay. So next is scripts. Once I've got these commandlets piped together into pipelines, then I can actually collect those into a text file, a .ps1 file, and then we can add parameters on there if we want so that we can prompt the user for input, or we can provide a parameter for a list of computers, or maybe the text file that we want to supply with a list of computers, things like that. And we edit those in the PowerShell ISE. So the ISE is the integrated script environment. Now, back in the day, it sounds like we got a lot of VBScripters on here. So I wrote VBScript for probably 12 years, and I was in Notepad every day. Or occasionally I would use Sapien's Primal Script, Notepad++, some of those tools that have been around for years. But now out of the box, we have a really stand-up, really good editor, PowerShell ISE with all the IntelliSense. And so we can maybe look at a little bit of that later. But so now I'm in that editor, and I'm going to run my script. So what do I do with it? Well, there are a number of ways that I can use that script. I just simply run the script, and it goes and does what it's supposed to. But then there are other things we can do with it as well. We can pass it to a remote machine using invoke command, and that will actually send that script over the wire to execute remotely and bring me the results back. So I don't even have to have access, RDP or anything else to another box. I do need permissions to get into it, but I can use invoke command to throw that over the wire and get the results back. I can also schedule it as a task or even use it as a logon script. So obviously lots of different ways that we can use this. And again, there's another help topic there about underscore scripts. So once we've got these scripts then, and we want to take those to the next level, we can start looking at functions. Now, functions are reusable sections of a script, let's say, or a few lines of code that does some magic or some special business logic. that you need to process. I've spent this week working on some scripts to migrate GPOs between domains. And I've got functions in there. I've got a function that will create a GPO migration table. And I've got another function that'll validate that table. And then another function that'll display that migration table. So they're usually a single purpose for your functions. And so that's where you've got a few lines that are, you know, performing some action. And then you just call that over and over in your script. And that's part of that satisfaction part of scripting is that, hey, look, now I've got this really cool function. And every time I call it, it just keeps bringing the result back. And it makes your script simpler. And it makes it clearer to follow. When I always tell this story on myself. When I was in college, my freshman year, I was taking Turbo Pascal 4.4. And anybody go back to Pascal days? So I had taught myself basic programming on a Commodore in the early 80s. And when I got to college, the professor introduced me to a new term called spaghetti code. He looked at my code and he said, "That's spaghetti code right there." So then I figured out real quick, there's a little bit more to this than the way I'd learned myself. So you want to make your scripts usable and maintainable, something that you can share with others and they can follow along as well. So, and the functions really help do that a lot because then it organizes it into these logical pieces of code. And then you can add parameters to those as well. And one of the best features now that we've got in V3 and V4 is the snippets shortcut, Control J. So you can hit the snippet shortcut key and it'll pull up a template for you that'll drop into your editor and you'll be able to take off and go with it and not have to worry too much about looking up the syntax, how these are supposed to work. You just hit Control J and pick that snippet of code, it drops in there and you just fill in your details. Makes it really nice. And there are several help topics on that as well. The get help about functions and some of those other ones, I reference those on a regular basis actually. For an example, one example here would be to prompt for a computer name and verify that it's online. How many times, maybe let's say in a script you want to target a different server, and so maybe you prompt the user to say, hey, enter the name of the server that you want to target. And they type in some bogus server name, and then your script tries to use that, it's going to fail. So what you could do is write a script or a function that says, hey, I want to get a good computer name. So let's call the function called getGoodComputerName. And what that function does is prompts for a server name, and then it tries to do, let's say, a ping or a WMI query against that box to make sure it's really up before it continues with the rest of the script. So you can write these little, you know, single purpose, you know, few lines of code functions and reuse them over and over like that. Then once you've got all those functions together, you can put those into what we call a module. And a module is probably a little bit more of an advanced topic that we probably won't have time to get into that tonight unless somebody has a specific question. But a module is where you can take these and kind of make your own commandlets. So your functions then become kind of like, for example, I work with the Active Directory module all the time. You might work with Exchange or SQL or SharePoint or any one of these other technologies that have modules that you can import. And then once you've got all these additional commands in your session, you can use them. And you can do that yourself with modules. So it's a way for you to take the code that you've written in a commandlet style format, and then you can import it into your session. You can share it with your team. You can put it on a share somewhere that everybody else can get to it. They can import it and use that same code library. And it makes it a great way to share code among your team. And even you can go out to TechNet Script Center and other code repositories online where other people have shared the modules they've written. You can then download those and import them into your session and begin to use those commands as well to save you a lot of time. So modules are the big step at the end as our development cycle progresses. And for beginners, something you probably don't need to worry about right away, but you want to definitely know how to work with other the modules that other people have written for you, and then over time you'll get comfortable with it too. And I tell folks learning PowerShell is like learning how to play the guitar. The first 6 months, your fingers hurt until you get those calluses built up. Then after that, the syntax starts to look more familiar to you, and before you know it, you're actually writing scripts. And hey, I just did that, and I didn't have to look at the help. And you kind of have these light bulb moments, and it starts to click. You know, and it just takes a little to get over that hurdle to become more familiar with it. So you can create modules then to bundle these different functions that you've written for all these different purposes. Let's say your help desk scripts or your reporting scripts and things like that. So that's a really quick overview of the life cycle of kind of PowerShell scripting and kind of where you want to build up to get and with your code. So what I'd like to do now is just take a pause right there and ask for questions. Let's start from the top. How many have written a module on the call in the room? How many have written a module?
Three?
Okay.
Yeah.
Good. All right. How many have written functions, your own functions, that you've written yourself for your own use?
A lot more hands there.
Six. A lot more hands.
Yep.
Okay, good. So this is not beginners as much, maybe. If you've written your own functions, you're doing all right with PowerShell. So what I want to do then is let's go through this kind of PowerShell discovery process. And, tell you what. If we've got people that have already written functions and modules, I can take this a different direction, because I don't want to bore people. If the intro stuff is going to be a little bit below the majority of everyone in the room. So maybe, tell you what, let's take a look at the list here. So kind of looking at this list of the scripting process, how many in the room have used show command before?
Onesie-twosie,
all right. So maybe it wouldn't hurt to go through some of the discovery process. I'll go ahead and go through that too, and then we can get on to maybe move a little more quickly through that and get to some of the function and module stuff. All right. So what I want us to do then is, if you've got your laptop with you, you're welcome to pull it out and kind of work along together. We can do this. What I want to do is take a look at some of the commandlets that we use to discover what we need to do next. So in this particular case, I've got a Windows 7 machine here running PowerShell version 3 that I downloaded, the Windows Management Framework. That's kind of another interesting question. What OS is everybody running at their companies? What's your machine at your company? How many Windows 7 folks do we have?
Majority of the room, Windows 7.
Okay. All right, so what I'm going to show you now is using PowerShell version 3 on Windows 7. So I would really recommend, PowerShell version 5 coming out next week. So go and PowerShell version 3 or 4 or even 5 later next week. If you go out to Microsoft Downloads, download.microsoft.com, Windows Management Framework, that's what will get you the next version of PowerShell. Out of the box on your Windows 7 machine, you're going to have PowerShell version 2. And it's good, but you want to go ahead and update to version 3 or version 4. It won't hurt your Windows 7 box any. You need to download the latest .NET framework and drop on there, and then put PowerShell version 3 at least. Probably version 4 would be a good one. And Bjorn pointed out here in the chat that we've got the version 5 preview I saw was released earlier this week, maybe yesterday. So I think I saw a release date on it because I went and searched on the WMF. Actually, I was out there today and I found the version 5 preview. So you can get that as well if you want. I would really encourage you to go download it, because here's the main reason. The ISE, the script editor, in version 3 and above is really nice. And I'll just give you a quick demo here in the version 3 editor. So if I'm going to type get dash, all of a sudden I've got this really rich IntelliSense. Get dash service is what I'm looking for, S-E-R, there it is. It pops up with the IntelliSense and shows me here are the different parameter sets that are available. I can tab complete through there, and then I put a space in my dash. Now it automatically gives me a list of all the possible parameters. And this next thing is what I really like. Now I can space and check this out. It actually it's like on the fly compiling the code, getting a list of services, and bringing back a list of live services on my machine right now. This is the IntelliSense built into the new ISE, and that's just the beginning of it. It is so much nicer than the version 2 ISE. Version 2 ISE was okay, but this one has several benefits that make it a lot easier. One of my other favorite shortcuts here is in version 2 ISE, if you wanted to run just this one line, you have to select it first and then the run selection button. Now in version 8, I can just hit the F8 key or run selection, and it runs that whole line without having to select it. I know that doesn't sound like a big deal, but when you're writing code all day long, that really helps things go a lot faster. So Bjorn says you can also use the show window command with F1. So if I click on commandlet and I hit F1, do a get help dash show window, and it pulls up the help for that commandlet. And it's much easier to read than scrolling through the blue window. So I can search things in here. There we go, display name. So it makes it a lot easier to work with. So especially if you're a beginner, to go download PowerShell version 3 at a minimum, or version 4, install that on your Windows 7 box. If you've got Windows 8, you're already there. Nothing to worry about. So we're on a Windows 7 box. It's SP1, PowerShell 3 installed here just as for demos. So what I want to do first is kind of talk through some of the discovery commandlets. How do I find the commands to get the data that I want? So our mission right now, our objective to kind of work through a scenario together, is to find the uptime and the last date a patch was applied to the box. So that's our goal. You need to have something to work for, and that's usually the best way to learn PowerShell, or anything for that matter, is you got to have something you're trying to accomplish. So what we're trying to accomplish here is I'm trying to find how long has this machine been up. Well, the first thing I need to do is I need to be familiar with the basic help system. So if I type get dash help, everybody's done that before, get dash help is going to tell me about the help system itself. Now, obviously it scrolls a lot, but what I can find here is I can type something like get help get process, for example, or get help on remoting, and it's going to search help for all the that keyword everywhere. So that's, I use that a lot to find the help for, that I'm looking for. But to, if I want to get a list of commands, back in the DOS days, you used to be able to type help, and it would give you a list of some of the built-in commands. Now I can type get command, and it's giving me a long list of all the commands that are available in my session. And get command, I can also say get command dash noun service, let's say. And that gives me all the commands that end with service. I can say get command dash verb, let's say start. And here's a list of all the things that I can use the start verb in PowerShell. So it's a great way to find what you're looking for. But the best part now in version 3, we have something called show command. And this is really wild. Well, I asked earlier how many of you show command. Show command, as some of you already know, this is a GUI that writes shell code. It's kind of like those old Mad Libs. I don't know what those when you're a kid, where it says, I need a verb, I need a noun, then you fill it all in, and at the end you got some goofy story. Well, here, we're writing commandlets that way. So what happens is, let's say I need to, let's say, some services here. So I'll put in service. and it drops, as I type, it filters the list. You can find there's the get service commandlet. There, these tabs present the three different parameter sets that we just looked at. And then here I can put in a name, just basically fill in the blank and run commands. So let's get service for bits. And then I just hit run. It types in the command for get service dash name bit now. So it's a GUI that writes code for me. I literally just fill in the blank. It couldn't be easier. The other thing I like about show command is that it helps me find and search through all these hundreds and hundreds of commandlets that are available. So let's say I want to do something with, say with computers here. And so I start typing the word computer, and I've got remove, rename, restart, all kinds of options that I can work with the computer. And so let's pick, I don't really want to restart or stop it. If I stop a computer, I'll be shut down. I can check a restore point, all kinds of things there. Let's take that out. I can also browse modules. Now, this is really handy up here at the top. Now I can actually go through and pick a list of commandlets based on a module. For example, PS scheduled job is a good one. Here's a list of these scheduled job commandlets that allow me to do scheduled job type things. So I can schedule something to run just like scheduled task. It's integrated with scheduled tasks, so I can get a scheduled jobs. I can create a job trigger that says run on certain days of the week. Now, notice it says, hey, I haven't imported the module yet, so I hit show details. And now it's going to give me the rest of the details here for this module as well and these functions. So show command is a great way to discover the commands that are going to get you what you need. Another good one, Bajorn mentioned earlier as well, was get sim class. Now I'm going to run this. The link is going to scroll, and it's going to be a little jerky probably. But this literally goes through thousands of namespaces. And this is where we can find the WMI data that we want. In version 3 and above, we have these new commandlets called sim commandlets. And we still have the old get WMI object commandlet, but we've got some new improved ones now with superpowers, the sim commandlets. So now if I do a get sim class, and let's say I'm looking for disk information, star disk star, and now I can find a list. There's a disk drive, logical drive, mapped logical disk, disk partition, disk quota, all kinds of disk-related information that I can find now. Let's say we, maybe that's not quite what we wanted. Maybe drive, maybe that's a word that might get us thing. So now I've got, we've got print driver, PMP sign driver. So we've got disk drive, physical media, all kinds of different names, classes of data that we can access now through WMI and SIM. So this, what I'm kind of covering here at the beginning is what we call the discovery. How can I find the commands and the help for those commands to do what I need to do? So our task so far is to find the uptime for a machine. So this is where I need your help. How do you go about finding the uptime on a machine? Where do you think we could find something like that? Any ideas?
One answer was Win32 computer system.
Win32 computer system, okay. Anybody else? Does everybody agree? Or you got some other ideas? You know, how would we find it? Bajorn Online says operating system, maybe. Okay. So it's going to come down to one of those two classes. Here's what I want to do. I want to find uptime. Now, I'm going to let you in on a kind of pull the curtain back a little bit. There is no statistic where I can grab the uptime straight out that I'm aware of. So how would I calculate uptime?
look at the last boot time.
Last boot time. Okay, now we're cooking. So I want to show you a trick here with getSim class. Now what we have is a property name search. So I'm looking for boot time information from the sim classes. So I want to put star boot star in here. And sure enough, we've got a vote for operating system and a vote for computer system. One of those is going to have the property that we need. So notice how we found that. GetSim class dash property name and then some part of that property name. This is invaluable because, like Bjorn said in the chat earlier, you know, we used to have to look this stuff up online all the time. Now we've got it at our fingertips, and it just makes scripting go so much faster. So let's do this. Let's say get sim instance. That's the new version of get WMI object here. Get sim instance. Win32 score operate. I'm not going to type the whole thing because in version 3 and above, we now have tab complete for the Win32 namespace, and I'm lazy. I'm going to use it. So we got operating system there. Obviously, that there's more to it. Who knows, how would I find the rest of the properties on here? It just gave me a few properties. How would I find the rest of them?
Pipe it to get member or format list star.
Okay, either one of those. I can pipe it to get. And that's going to give me a long list. Or I can pipe it to format list star. That'll give me the same property names, but I like this better sometimes because it puts actual data in there so I can see if it has what I want. Scroll through this list and see if we find anything that has boot in it. There's boot device. So that's probably not what we're looking for. Oh, wait, there's last boot up time. Hey, we found it. Look at that. Last boot up time. So what we want then... We did a get sim instance on Win32 operating system, and we are going to type in select boot up time. And I copied that, so I have to type it again. There we go. Hey, we found it. So get sim instance, Win32 operating system, and we found the last boot up time. And we did that using show command and get sim class. Format list star boot star. Bjorn says, hey, that's a nice trick. Let's try that. Let's see. Format list abbreviated to FL star boot star. Hey, look at that. I like that. That's a great tip, Bjorn. Very good. So now we've got the last boot up time, but we need to know uptime. And in this case, I'm going to use show command to find a list of commandlets that are time related. Now, before I jump in here too far, I'm going to go in and delete this module folder here. All right, so let's launch this again here. Shoop, whoops. Show command, there we go. And I'm looking for a commandlet that works with time. And find new dash time span. I could put in date as well, and I'll find get date. But in this case, we're looking for time, and there was a hint in the opening quote, give a man a fish, feed him for a get date, teach a man to fish, feed him for a new dash time span. If you've not used this commandlet before, this one is really handy. So let's take a look at the help on this. It says I can give it a start and end date, I can give it hours, minutes, seconds. Well, let's click the little help icon here and see what it does. How do we use this? We see the start is in parentheses or in square brackets. That means it's optional. But it says it lets us create a time span, an interval that you can use to subtract time from date time objects. Without parameter, time span returns a time span object that results in a zero time interval. And if we scroll down far enough to look at the examples down here at the bottom, what we'll find, we've got an end date specified here. We've got 90 days, a time span, dash days 90. So let's take a look then. What you can do with new dash time span is we'll come out here. And I'm going to grab that last boot up time, but let me show you a little trick here. Notice when I do select last boot up time, it has a property name. That means it actually has an object with a single property. I'll show you a little shortcut here. Select dash expand property will give me just the value, just this date time value. And this is a handy little tip, because sometimes you kind of wrestle with this. You have to put dot last boot up time. Maybe you don't want to do that. Well, you can use dash expand property instead. And it'll bring back just the value, so you don't have to put the dot last boot up time. And that's really handy. As you grow in your PowerShell scripting experience, that's going to be one of those little tricks that you're going to use over and over. So what we want to do now is we want to take that whole thing. And the other day, my son was studying his algebra, and I heard them use the phrase, "Please excuse my dear Aunt Sally." Has anybody ever heard that before?
Yep.
"Please excuse my dear Aunt Sally." What's that? What's that stand for?
Parentheses.
Anybody know?
Exponents.
My division, addition, subtraction.
Yeah, there you go.
There we go. Order. "Please excuse my dear Aunt Sally." So parentheses are first. So in PowerShell, we can use parentheses. I'm gonna up and modify this previous line here and put some parentheses around it. And so what that says in PowerShell, do everything in the parentheses first, and then I'm going to insert a new time span in front of it. And what that does is it says, give me a new time span from that boot time date to now. And whenever I specify a new time span, it's assuming this is the start time with no start parameter in there. If you don't give it an end time, it assumes now was the end time. So check out these properties that we get now. We've got total days, total hours, total minutes, and so forth. So now we can actually calculate uptime for the box, because we found the boot ups in WMI. And then we calculated the difference from the current time. So here, if I want total days of uptime, you can see this machine's not been up very long at all. It was just booted a little while ago. So that then becomes our uptime. So what I'll do is at the very end of that, I'm going to put a parenthesis dot total days. And I'm going to go to the beginning of the line and put a parenthesis there. And so now what I've done is I've, again, put all of that parentheses, and I say I just want this total days property coming off the end of it here. So that now in one line of code shows me how many days this machine has been up. Again, I can't even imagine, start to think how many lines of script that would take. So in one line, we've calculated uptime now in days. Pretty slick. Then we assign that to a variable, and let's just call it $updates equals that value. So now anytime I want to look at it again, $updates. All right. So far, so good. Questions? Is this, are we going too slow? Is this stuff you already know? Kind of give me some feedback. Do we want to pace, or is this right on track?
Everything good?
Yeah,
it's good. We're good. The question is, when you form a parenthesis, like a lambda extension,
what's that?
When you form like a new parenthesis, and then put the parenthesis around command, not the way to show up the extension.
Yeah,
Yeah, because he's referencing a property out of the new time span, so first he has to put that in parentheses.
No, I think
the question, Ashley, is related to if you wrap your expression in parens, is it a lambda expression? Is it similar to a lambda expression? I'm not familiar with that.
I guess I'm not familiar with the term lambda expression. What does that mean?
I guess it's more of like a programming construct.
Programming language is an inline function. It's a function that you don't even give a name. You just write the code for the function as part of whatever is going to run the function.
Okay, so it's an expression that essentially operates as a function, but it's not defined. It's like
on
the fly, I guess.
Like a dynamic function kind of thing?
That's what I'm gathering, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, this is the style of PowerShell.
Question? We have another question, sorry.
Okay.
Is there an equivalent to more? If you just use command prompt and you get an output that scrolls past the single page, you can type it to more.
You can do that in the console, but you can't. You have very limited success when you do it in the ISE host, yeah.
So there's nothing equivalent for ISE right now?
Not that I'm aware of, yeah.
But let's talk about that. There are two ways to do piping to more in the console. If I do a get process, it's going to be a long list of processes. And I can pipe that to more. Let me warn you very quickly here. Be very careful that you don't mistype that and type move instead. I learned that the hard way. I accidentally piped. I was doing a directory recursively, and I piped it to move instead of more. And there's no undo for that.
I assume it's not a problem on your process, but if you're working with file system objects.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. So here we got get process, pipe it to more, and it does what you would expect. If I use the space bar, it does the page. If I use the enter key, it does one line at a time. Now, here's the difference. More actually executes the entire previous command before it streams it through the pipeline. The truly PowerShell way to do this is outhost-paging, which does the same thing, except it treats it as a stream. So what you're seeing right now is half of a get process execution. It hasn't executed the rest of it yet. And it actually is a little bit quicker. Again, not that it really matters one way or the other. Usually it's not going to be that big of a performance deal, but it is more stream-oriented when you use outhost-paging. And so it carries return, get a new line, space to get the next page. So that was outhost-paging. That's the true PowerShell way to do more. Sure. Good questions. All right. So let's take our property then that we've gotten here. Oh, by the way, a little shortcut for you. If you use the F7 key, this has been around since DOS days, but you can use F7 to get a list of your recently executed commands, and you can use the up arrow and enter to execute it again. You can use the up arrow, and then let's say we get to the right arrow key, and it'll retype it without executing it. So in PowerShell, you do a long thing. That's going to save you typing right there. Use F7. And that you can also type get-history, and it'll give you to the previous commands that you've run. So there are a couple ways to look at your session history as well. So let's keep moving, though. We've got some other things we want to accomplish here. So we found the last boot up time property and we calculated the last boot up time, the uptime. So we've kind of got that. How would I find the last date that a patch was installed on the machine? Any ideas there?
Any thoughts? I'm thinking.
Man's what I used.
Get hotfix.
Okay. Get hotfix. Got a couple people with that already. But let's say I didn't know there was a commandlet called get hotfix. I could have to type something like get help star patch star. Does that thing? It's searching through all the help. And not really. I'm not sure how patch comes out of those three, but not a lot there. So next, if I look at get help star hotfix star, then yeah, all of a sudden it finds that help topic for me. And I can scroll back through there and say, okay, there's a get hotfix commandlet. So if I type get hotfix, it actually is, it's a little bit slow. It takes it a bit to go find all the hotfixes that have been installed, but sure enough, there they are. And it gives me the name of my machine, the type of hotfix, and the KB name, and then sometimes it'll give me an account that it was installed under. There are other properties as well here. We can pipe that to get member and see what all the other properties are. We can see the date that it was installed on. Look at that. That's what we're looking for. And we also have install date right here. So let's say we do a get hotfix and we sort it by install date. Now it's not showing it. We want to actually show those. So let's do a format table. And the property that we want is going to be hotfix ID. Hotfix ID and install date. Now, where did that go? It didn't, must have typed that wrong. Let's try installed on. There we go. So here we've got a list of when that was installed, and it looks like the date decision does not include the time in the timestamp here, perhaps just the date that it was installed, because they all show 12 a.m. So what we want to do then is we want to find the last date that a hotfix was installed. So we're sorting it by installed, sort on install date. What we can do is we can say select last one. So if we're sorting it in ascending order, we select the last one. It gives us just that one. And then we pipe that to select installed on. And we'll use that expand property trick again. And now we have the date of the last hotfix install. So the total uptime, and we have the last date a patch was applied using those commands. And I realize I kind of went through that a little quickly without explaining a whole lot. Questions on this piece? How we use the pipeline is really the magic here, because we got a list of hotfixes, we piped it to a sort, ascending, and then we selected just the last one, and then we grabbed just the property installed on from that last one. And again, this is one line of code, and this point illustrates the pipeline. I can do all of that in one line of code. Questions?
Any questions?
What would you do if you wanted to get the time span of this date and also the hotfix ID?
Did you hear that okay?
Mm-hmm. So we want the time span from, so what, how long has it been since the last patch, and the ID. So let's do, So first off, what we're going to do is we want to get just that last hotfix. So I'm going to up arrow and grab just that last hotfix right here. And I'm going to assign that to a variable, $lastHotfix equals getHotfix, sort by installed on, select the last one. So now $lastHotfix is going to be just that one. And then I can say $lastHotfix.HotfixI and $lastHotfix.installedOn. But we don't want the date it was installed, we want a time span. So what I'm going to do then is say new-timespan here to that last installed on date. And that'll give me that. Now, I'll show you another trick here in a second, but for, I want to just pause right there. So we just assigned that last hotfix to a variable so that it makes it a little easier to work with. And I can just hotfix ID property off of that and the installed on and pass that to the new time span. So according to this, it's been 413 days since that last hotfix was installed. So let me show you another little trick here that's going to be a really good one for your bag of tricks in PowerShell. It's called a sub-expression. Actually, no, that's not what it's called. Well, we're going to do a calculated column with select. And if you look at the help for select object, select, I've been using the alias just select, show window here. And we're going to drop down to the examples, example number 6, if I remember correctly. No, it's not example 6. Let's see, which one is it? Here we go, example 4. Here's what I want you to see. Can everybody see that on the screen okay? The blue piece? This is a way that you can calculate something in the middle of a select statement. So sometimes you want to calculate a property. Maybe you've got bytes coming back from the size of a file, and you want to instead show it in megabytes. So you can calculate how many bytes divided megabytes and then show the size of the file in megs instead of bytes. So, excuse me, sometimes you want to select calculations in there. So what we've got in this case is some special syntax that says at per, and curly braces, name equals the column title that we're going to get back, and then expression is what our calculation is going to be also inside of curly braces, and that dollar underbar represents the object. In this case, process is coming through the pipeline. So let's play with this for a second. And what I want to show you then is that we can actually select this all out into a single row of results. So if I take my dollar last hotfix here, and I pipe that to a select object, and I know I've got hotfix ID right there, but I want to now get the calculation. So I'm going to copy this. Just click and drag and then hit the enter key to copy it. And I'm going to create a new column here that says name equals say days ago for lack of something better, and we'll say expression equals and then these curly braces that go around it, and I'm just going to paste it in there. Now truly, I should probably change this to a dollar underscore right here. So that's the installed on property coming through. That's weird. Okay, so we got 413 days and hours, minutes, seconds, milliseconds. Okay, that's really interesting the way it did that. So we've got hotfix ID and how many days ago it was installed.
You're going to have to install
that
total days.
You know what? You're exactly right. I forgot to put that in. That was the installed on. And let's do dot total days. There we go. 413 days ago. All right. So this is an example of the discovery process. What we're doing is we've tried to find the commandlets that are going to get the data that we need, and then we've manipulated those commandlets using help. We use show help, the show window option. We use show command to discover the commands that we need and to discover which properties we're going to use on those to get the results back. And that's really what I wanted to focus on in this session, was really going over the process of scripting, because a lot of times as beginners, we read articles and it might be talking about a particular commandment or commandlet or a way to use it, but it doesn't go over this piece of it until you actually sit down with somebody and watch them go through this discovery process. It's all kind of a mystery. You know, you open up the blue window and now what? So now hopefully you've gotten some ideas on how to get started scripts, how to find those commands, and find those things that you need to get that data. So I want to take a checkpoint here. It's 10 after 7. How long have we been going? I don't want to talk all night long. I mean, I could keep for as long as you guys want to go, but I can go for another half hour. So it's just up to you guys, however long you guys want to go.
I think you're good to keep going.
Okay. Nobody's fallen asleep yet? Everybody's good?
No, everybody's with you.
All right. So what we can do next, let's say, is let's write a function next. Let's do a function next. So what we've done is we've got these lines of code, and I'm going to actually copy these. Click and drag in here, hit enter, and I'm going to come down to my ISE and paste that in and then kind of clean it up. And I need to go back to my console and grab some other commands here. So I've got last hotfix here. Grab that command. So this is the real process of scripting. That's what I wanted you to take away tonight. See how this really works, because now what I've done is I've gotten the things kind of working at the command line, and I want to paste them into a script that I can then reuse. And that's really the process that I go through. Now, you'll notice here, I'm kind of a neat freak. I'm a perfectionist, and I like all of my case to be perfect, and I don't like to use aliases in scripts. So what I do is I come back in here and I just kind of tab complete things to kind of finish them out so that I'm not using aliases anywhere. And forgive me, I'm just kind of a neat freak like that. So I like to make it look really clean, precise. All right. So there we go. So now I can actually run this as a five, or the run button up here. I'm going to first squeegee my output pane and remove that output. Now when I run it, it's actually a script and it returns the results that I want. Cool. So now I can save that and rerun it anytime. Invoke command and run that script on a remote machine and bring the results back. Lots of things I can do with that script. So the next thing I want to look at then is how do we get a computer name. A computer name that's going to be reliable. I want to create a function that's going to return a validated computer name that I know is online. So let's create a new tab here. Who knows, how do I get a prompt from the user? So for example, in VBScript, there was something called an input box function. It'd pop up and say, you know, you'd give it some title and a little icon, and it would say, you know, what do you want to do? give me the name of a computer user. How do I do that in PowerShell? Does anybody know?
Read host.
Read host, yeah. So if we come out here and we say help, I'm looking for user input. That's what I'm looking for help on. I want to find some way to get user input. And I look through these commands that it returns. Help star, user star, input star. That's kind of what I'm looking for. And there it is, read host. So I discover the commandlet. And now I type in help for read host. And it says I can use a prompt and add a secure string. I don't think I need that one. So I'm going to give them a prompt then. So let's say read host dash prompt computer name. And it prompts me computer name. I type in DC1. It comes back and it just says DC1. So let's assign that to a variable. Dollar computer name equals read host prompt. So now I prompt for the computer name. Let's say server 2. Now it's in the variable dollar computer name server 2. Cool. Now, the only problem with that is server 2 is not a real computer, right? So we need to validate that some way. So I'm going to copy that line and put it over here in my script. And I can run that in the ISC, and this time when I run it, it gives me my prompt down here. I'll put in server 4. All right, so we captured it. Now I'm just going to highlight that variable name, hit the run selection, just to show me, okay, server 4 is inside the variable. But what if I want to guarantee that that's a good computer? Well, I gave you a hint earlier. We're going to need to put this into a function. Some way that's going to validate that I did get a good computer. Does anybody remember the shortcut key I mentioned earlier that would help me with some template code?
Control J.
Control J, yeah. So I'm going to hit Control. And I've got an advanced function and a function. Let's see, do we have just a, there we go, just a plain function. Let's come down here. Now I've got just a plain function right there. So it puts the function keyword in there, the title, and some parameters. And I'm going to call this function get-good-computer-name. And I really don't need to take any parameters coming in. I just want to return a computer name. And then I'm going to take this little prompt here and put it inside of that function. Now, in my script, I'm going to come over here and I'm going to call that function. Actually, I'm going to go ahead and run that once. So now I can type get-good. Look at that. Autocomplete, the IntelliSense is working already for a function that I just now created, get-good-computer-name. So I can run that, and it prompts me for a computer name. Server 6. And now what we want to do is we want our function to return that computer name at the end. Return dollar computer name. Now the return is optional. You don't have to put that in there. I could just say dollar computer name and that would be the output from the function. Be just fine. If you're kind of a neat freak, you can put return in there. That's fine. So now actually I'll run it again. It prompts for the computer name, server 7, and it returns, it spits out server 7 when it's done. Now again, this isn't really doing what we want yet. We want to make sure that we get a good computer name. So what we're going to do then, can anybody think of a way that we could validate that that's a real computer that's online?
Ping it or test connection?
Okay, test connection. That's the PowerShell version of ping.
Seems so.
So, programming construct or what syntax would I use for that? If I want to do something until I get a good result, what would that look like in script?
Do like a if.
Anybody know? We could if. Okay, so I could ping that, and if it didn't come back, I would just return nothing.
One second. We have a we have a question.
Can we do
okay.
The extra service, after the error service, and then we call from that one to get exactly what it is.
Get so do a directory services lookup. I'm sorry, I didn't hear.
Okay, we could do a directory services lookup and make sure that it's a valid computer account, but that still doesn't tell me for sure that it's online right now. So I think we can go with the test connection. Another check would be a get WMI call against it or test it with a PowerShell remoting session. A number of different ways you could test it. Let's go with test connection since that's an easy one. First off, what is test connection? Let's come down here. And I'm going to say test dash connection, if I can spell. CV member 1 is one of my servers here. And it actually does a WMI ping. Does 4 pings. The cool thing about this is it only shows you those 4 properties, but when I look at this in get number, it actually has a number of other properties here related to timeout, route record, status code, you name it, reply size, record, all kinds of really interesting information. And the good thing why I would use this instead of a ping is because I use a ping, I have to parse all that flat text that comes back from a ping. Now I've got it just here. So I can say something like this. Let's say, let's test a bad one. Test connection foo. There's no computer called foo. So what comes back there? It's giving me an error. All right. So let's come back over here. Then let's say we're going to get a computer name and use a do until loop. We're going to say do this little script block right here. Until something is true. And so here we're going to say test connection dollar computer name, and we're also going to give it a count of just one ping. We don't need to do 4 pings. We'll just do one ping to make sure it's a good computer name. So this says do read host prompt for computer name until we can test that we actually get a ping to that machine. Everybody follow me on that one?
Mm-hmm.
All right, so now let's function here. Computer name, foo. It tries to ping it, and it gets an error. All right, let's try ASDF. That's not a good computer name either. Nope, it errors out. So now let's put in a good one. CV member 1, that's a good computer name. And then it returns, actually, with that result, of a good computer name. That's a really simple example of how you can use a function to see your results in your script. Now, Bjorn's saying this, we've got a new test-net connection. There's also a property called ping succeeded you can use. Well, that's good to know, Bjorn. Cool. Test-net connection. I haven't played with that commandlet yet. Very good. So the other thing I want to do is I want to hide this error message. I'll show you how to do that here. Most of your commandlets have some built-in commands. I want to show you. This. You may not have noticed this, especially if you're a beginner to intermediate. If you look at the help on test connection, I want you to notice at the end of the help syntax it says common parameters. And you'll see this for a lot of, most of the commandlets in all of PowerShell support common parameters. Well, what's that mean? That means I've got all these parameters defined for this commandlet, and also some common parameters that everybody gets. Well, you know, there is a help topic about that. Help about common. And it explains here, let me scroll down, here's what we're looking for. Help about common parameters says that we have a common parameter called error action. And with error action, we can tell it to successfully continue if it gets an error, so it doesn't display that red text. Actually, the only person that does not get red text at the PowerShell console is Chuck Norris. Yeah, so let's go down here and let's find error action. That's warning preference. Error action right here. Silently continue, continue, inquire, or stop. So what we want to do in our script, notice this process. I do this all the time when I'm writing scripts. I toggle back and forth between the console and my ISV. I kind of use so as my workbench. I kind of try things over there and check some help and kind of kick the tires on some commandlets. And then once I find something that's what I want, then I copy and paste it into my script over here in the ISE. So we found that there's an error action parameter here, error action, tab complete. This is gorgeous. And now in the IntelliSense lets me pick. It gives me a list of what I want to put after that, silently continue. Awesome. So now I shouldn't see that red text. So what I'm going to do is squeegee the output window again. And I'm going to run this script. All right, so here it's running. It's prompting me for a computer name, foo. It's trying to ping it. Oh, look, no red text. That's cool. Computer name again. Didn't give you a good one last time. This is not a good one either. Let's do CVDC1. And hey, look, it comes back with a good computer name that time. So that's the functions in PowerShell. This is a very simple example, but in this case, I want to get a computer name that's a good computer name. I want to make sure that it's online so that I can pass that computer name into the next command knowing that I'm going to get a callback. So how could we use this? What if we did a get hotfix against that computer name? The get hotfix commandlet has the dash computer name parameter. Come back over here. And we look at help on get hotfix. We see there's a computer name parameter. So you can see we're headed somewhere with this. Now we take everything we just did earlier about the hotfix and the last date that it was installed on. We pass in a good computer name now to this get hotfix command. And as long as we're running under the right credentials to hit that remote box, we should be able to get back a response from it. So let's try this. Now we want to put this function to use. So let's say I do a get hotfix dash computer name, and I'm in parentheses here, I'm going to put get good computer name so that it actually calls out and does that first. It gets back a good computer name, and then it's going to pass that computer name into the get hotfix for a valid computer name. So let's try this now, see if it works. Computer name foo, we know that doesn't exist. Computer name ASDF doesn't exist. And now let's put in another computer name, CV member 1. Now my guess here is that we're going to get an access denied. Let's see what happens. Oh, it worked. I must be logged in as administrator. Okay, cool. So now it goes out with that validated computer name and retrieves the last hotfix. So now we've got our other code with the hotfix selection that we can paste in here as well. So we say last hotfix. Let's copy this code over here now. And let's use this code. So let's say last hotfix equals get hotfix. And then we're going to sort that by, let's just do this. Let's recycle this code here so we don't have to keep typing. Now, oh man, we are cooking with gas. We are scripting. This is fun. Let me change the zoom level a little bit so we can see all this now. So now what we're going to do is we're going to prompt the user until they give us a valid computer name. And we're going to go grab off of that computer the last hotfix. Here's the computer name now. Whoops. We've passed in that, now that good computer name to the computer name parameter. We're going to grab the last install date, and then we're going to select off the hotfix ID and the total days since that hotfix was installed. Let's run it. So computer name again, invalid computer name. Next, we'll put in a good one, CV member 1. And then it comes back, cool, hotfix, and how many days ago it was. What do you think? Is that good stuff?
We'd shout, but you can't hear us.
I can hear some whistling. I can hear some shouting. All right. Okay, so... This is what the scripting process looks like, and I was sitting down at my laptop probably a year ago thinking, you know, this process that I'm using to write scripts, this is what people need to see. We can talk about new command modules, but really you need to see somebody go through this discovery process, because that helps everybody realize that I'm not alone. It's not just me. It takes a while over the hump to get things going and to find what I need. And everybody goes through this process. And I've been doing PowerShell now for right about 4 years after doing VBScript for a dozen years. And I still use help every day. I use and I use get command. I use these commands all the time. And it's even though I've been using PowerShell for years and I have a blog on TechNet, I use help, okay? And I use it every time I write a script. And that's what I wanted to show in this session, was to really demonstrate what is it like to sit down at that blue window and go from scratch and write your own script. How do I discover those commandlets that I need? And how do I use the help? How do I get in there and find the right parameters? And then how do I put this into something that's usable? So now we actually have a really cool little script here that's got a function, get good computer name. I can call that thing a million times and it'll just keep, and it's only ever going to return a valid computer name. And that is satisfaction right there, knowing that I've built a tool, a little cog, so to speak, that goes into my machine of a script. And so then I call that function, I get a good computer name, then I do something meaningful with that computer. I want to go get the last hotfix that was installed on it and how many days ago that was. Because my boss wants to know if we are in compliance on our patching. And so I need to run this now against the list of all the servers in my environment to make sure that they're all up to date. Does that hit home? Does that help?
Yeah, absolutely.
That's good. I have a question on the. I think there's a bug in what you've got there.
Sure.
I don't think it's been 161 days since your last update. I think you need to change the sort object to installed on instead of installed date.
So the suggestion is to change the sort.
Yeah, that's a good catch. Sort it by installed on.
It's going to create an error. That installed date property doesn't exist, and it didn't make an error. So that was interesting.
Actually, it is correct.
It's not mine. I got a different answer on mine when I changed that. Okay.
What version of PowerShell are you using?
Well, I just installed 4. Before I had 2.
Oh, okay. Let look then at get hotfix, because when I used get member earlier, it showed that property. Let me do an FL here and see. Scroll for ways. Should have done a select last one on that one. Come on, fish. There we go. So let's take a look. Install date and is blank. You're right. And installed on is populated. Yep, that's a good catch. You know, I tell you what, doing this stuff for years.
That's all. Happened.
Go ahead, I can't hear you.
Okay. It still seemed to work, though. You still got the same day.
Well, I mean, if he was in, it was blank data, so no matter what, he would have gotten the same thing.
Well, let me peel back the curtain for you. The reason why this came up same date either way is because this is a generic 2012 RTM VM that has had no successive patches applied. This is just a vanilla 2012 RTM VM in my lab, so it has not had any patches applied, and that's why it's not really going to give you a valid last date. So.
Also appears that it's installed on a script property, so it's not an actual property. It looks like it's actually doing some sort of check on the OS version and build. It's created a certain number that's actually pulling a date, which makes it less talking about getting it.
Yep. And there's always more than one way to do things in PowerShell. We could grab this from WMI, which actually is what Get Hotfix is probably doing on the back end. There are a couple different ways we could pull it in. And actually, this is kind of old school, too. This is like early PowerShell version 2, probably. I tried to keep this at the lowest PowerShell level so that it would be compatible on everybody's machines. On, you know, version 3, version 4, or version 5, we'd probably do some kind of remoting to pull the data back or invoke commands, something to hit that computer in a different protocol. And so there's, again, a number of ways to do this exact same thing. Doesn't mean any one of them is right or wrong. As long as you get the data you need and it's accurate, that's the main point. Okay. So, again, because I've given this session a couple of times, and we always kind of get narrowed down into the details of what we're doing in the script. And in this particular session, it's not really about what we're doing necessarily in the script, but how we got to this point. And that's what I want you to see, how I'm kind of alternating between the console and trying some things, pasting into the script pane, and then I can save this script now. Let's just save this, and just to finish up here, I'm going to save this in my PhillyPoSH folder, and I'm going to call it get dash computer last hotfix.ps1. Get computer last hotfix PS. Come here and go to users administrator, if I can spell. Documents, PhillyPoSH, and here's my dash computer last hotfix PS1 file. So now I'm out inside, I have a completely different PowerShell session now, and now it's prompting me for a computer name. And I'm running the script, and it's doing what it's supposed to do. It's calling that computer name function, and I put in my member server name there, and it comes back with the result. That is the satisfaction of running a PowerShell script right there. Because now I can run that script, I can give it to other people. You know, if they just, somebody needs to check, maybe they just need a quick check like this to do something. Maybe help desk needs to see when's the last date a patch was applied to that workstation. They can just run the script, computer name, and it'll come back and tell them. And that's the kind of simple, quick satisfaction that you can get with PowerShell scripting. Well, I have been talking a long time, and you guys have been very patient. This has been fun. It's always fun for me. I could talk for the rest of the night on this stuff. You know, we didn't – obviously, there's more than enough content here. We could get into how do you take those functions then and put them into modules, and then how do you install those and share those. But What I've done is I want to go ahead and wrap things up here. I have all of this content available for you out on my blog. And this is actually from the Charlotte session of PowerShell Saturday. So at PowerShell Saturday back in February, I presented similarly in two sessions. I did a part one, a part two. All the notes that I've shared, my slides, all the scripts are all here as a download on this. And there's also a recording of the full session of the part one and part two. Part two goes more into functions and modules and how to do that. Similar kind of demo with uptime and hotfixes. And then at the bottom, there are some links for you on some free training on Microsoft Virtual Academy for the PowerShell beginner, especially, and advanced. Actually, there's a jumpstart PowerShell and a tool and scripting with PowerShell, which the second one goes into your modules and functions and things like that. Also, some books by Ed Wilson there and a download for the scripting essentials that includes the slide deck, and it includes all the sample scripts. I have, kind of like Bobby Flay in the kitchen, I've got all these scripts already written for you here. And so now I've got, pull it out of the oven. Hey, look, at the end of the show, it's already there. So here are all these types of things already scripted out for you to look at. This looks almost identical to what we just did here. Get computer name function, okay, get uptime. And so I've kind of gone through and each one of these demo scripts adds something to the previous one, so you can see this logical progression of building out a script from start to finish. So those are out there for you to download, and I'll put that URL back up on the screen here. Let me get that presentation back up. There we go. So the way the scripting lifecycle works is you get the core functionality done, phase one. You write, test, debug, write, test, debug, write, test, debug. You kind of get your code actually functional, and that's the first requirement. It's got to work. It's got to do what it's supposed to do. Phase two is making it friendly. So it's functional, then it goes to friendly. You got to put some documentation in there, some comments, some error handling, logging, things that kind of make it a little more robust. Then finally, as phase three is released, that's where you give the script to the people that need it. You publish it online in TechNet Script Gallery. You have to then update it, do some version control. And the last bullet's the one nobody likes, is support, because they know where they got that script, and they're going to come back to you, and they're going to get mother scripts, and they're going to ask you to help with that script. Oh, now I need it to do this. And so that's called job security, and that's what keeps us all feeding the family. So that's a good thing. So that's kind of the overview. And again, that's all summarized in that blog post. So here's the URL again. Actually, I'll put it up here. The blog is aka.ms/gotpfe. And I'm not here to plug my blog. I'm just here to give you that as a resource. Because I put it out there so that you could have a copy of everything that we worked on and take it back and practice for your own practice and learning. So if you go out to aka.ms/gotpfe and then you scroll down two or three, four posts, you'll see the one from PowerShell Saturday in Charlotte. And it's got all that on there. I think the guys, when they posted the link for tonight's invitation, they also mentioned PowerShell Summit and Tech Mentor coming up. Now, those are two great events where you can come meet some more PowerShell people and learn from them. PowerShell Summit's coming up at the end of the month, and that's going to be in Redmond on Microsoft campus. So if it's not too late, you've still got a little training budget left, you can head out there and meet some of the PowerShell celebrities all around the world that you've seen on Twitter and on the blogs. They'll be there, and you get a chance to meet even Jeffrey Snover, the guy that invented PowerShell. So it's going to be a fun event, PowerShell Summit, in April 25th. And then Tech Mentors coming up in August. That's also going to be in Redmond, and you'll get to be on campus there and hang out and see some other folks there. I'll be speaking at both those events, and I'd love to meet you there. Okay, I think that wraps up my piece of things. Any other questions on what we've done here?
Any questions, guys? No, that seems to be it. Ashley, thank you very much for your time. It was a great presentation. And, yeah, thank you.
Oh, you're welcome.
Really appreciate it. And we'll link off to all that stuff, your blog post and the demo sample files and everything on our follow-up post on PowerShell.org.
Great.
Yeah, so thanks a lot.
No, you're welcome. I'll just hang on the call here. I don't have anywhere else to be, so I'll just hang on and listen to whatever you guys have to wrap up. So.
Cool, man.
And I can hang around for any other questions afterwards, too.
Cool. Let me see. Just go. All right, so we're looking at like 7:45. So we'll just go through some news items. I don't know if anybody has anybody in the room got a chance to play with Desired State at all?
Yeah.
I started to dip into it.
So what do you use it for?
Nothing yet in production, but we have. So we have some systems at work that are driving like LCD panels, and they use like a custom application. And quite frequently, you know, we'll find these systems in like a weird state where, like, after a patch is applied or the machine is rebooted, the content player software doesn't load correctly. So we've been troubleshooting. I've been kind of looking at that, and then it seems like a good excuse to use Desired State to just check a process, see if a service is running, if a process isn't running.
I thought Desired State was mainly builds.
I think you could. It's Yeah. So there's you know, the more, you know, I just started looking at it, but the more and more I research into it, it seems like you have the opportunity to pretty much, there's pretty good coverage. What's up on the screen, actually, what I should do is present this.
There is a...
see if you guys can see this.
A podcast. If anybody has an Apple device.
Which podcast was that?
There's the PowerShell community, which I think has done two or three on DSC. They've also gone through, I don't know how many of you would do that podcast, but they've gone through it not just with the Windows DSC, but also with other products, such as
Yeah, so this is the guy, Steven Morawski. I caught him. I was up at Tech Extravaganza up in New York City just a couple weeks ago, and listened to him give a presentation on DSC. But he's been really heavy in the DSC space, and he's a systems engineer for Stack Exchange, so Stack Overflow and all that. All those Stack Exchange properties that they host, and they're using it in production and have been for some time. So on the PowerShell.org GitHub repo, there's some community content for DSC, including some community-driven resources. So resources are essentially in PowerShell. Let me see. Send something in the chat. Cool. So resources are kind of like in. Just open the IC here. We have this new keyword where you define a function, you do function, and then curly braces, and you define your function code within those curly braces. There's a new keyword for a configuration, and that's basically like your DSC specific configuration logic that would be there to process your DSC stuff. So just curious if anybody was looking at it or playing with it yet. I think
we may play with it later. We actually built very similar. That's what we, the only thing we don't use, all we do is support our business units.
automatically remediated. But we do report on it and show, or check things that we care about. But we built something internally, kind of does obviously before that came out.
Yeah.
Like, we released ours kind of
right
at the same time that they kind of came out. There's some work that we're going to be here.
Yeah.
Is it, I mean, theoretically, isn't it, wouldn't it be a bad practice for the automatic remediation? Because then you don't necessarily know if something's wrong or you're not fixing the underlying problem that's putting these devices in.
So there's two modes. There's a push model and then there's a pull model. And I believe that you have the ability to push a configuration down as a one-time application. So I have this, you know, declarative document that describes what I want my configuration to look like. So, you know, deploy server 2012, and then I want it to have these roles and these features, and I describe that in my DSC document, and I have that pushed down to the box, and it applies those changes. And then there's a service that runs as part, you know, like the core engine of DSC that runs on the box and will then take your data, your declarative document, and then apply those changes. And that's like a one-time application of those things. And then you can have, machines enrolled in like the pull model where they will periodically check in on a given interval, like 15 minutes or 30 minutes, or whatever you define as the, for your environment. And then if there's some drift or some configuration item that you've defined in your declarative code, it'll go ahead and remediate that or put it into the state that you define it should be in.
And
depending on what that
question kind of revolves around is organizational decision, what it is. And I think where a lot of people get the hang up is the automatic remediation. Because, well, I don't know what's happening. We've been in this mode for so long in IT as to knowing exactly what's going on in the system. Where the model has kind of moved, and this is, you know, pretty much from, you know, cloud kind of technology where
it doesn't
really matter what's wrong with it, just fix it, in a sense. Where I know this is a web box, and this has to be in the same state as the other ones, otherwise it doesn't work correctly. So other environments don't really match that in some ways, like ours. We have very specific things that we do within our environment, but it doesn't really work on. But with DSC, are you able to remediate and also report?
So that was the biggest problem with V1 of DSC, is that the reporting capabilities really weren't there. It was all about just, you wrote a check, how do I check this? But it didn't really give you a report saying, here's what I changed. Because I think that if you had that capability, I think it'd be a very different conversation. Because then you can say, hey, here's what changed in the box last night, and or here's the report from yesterday, here's the report today that were different, and obviously that got automatically fixed.
Yeah, I'd be very surprised not to see in future versions a more fleshed out reporting piece. Essentially, the mechanics to do reporting are there. There's three core, as far as I understand. There's a test. Essentially, you write a test, you write a set, and you write a get. So with that get, you could essentially do your reporting piece,
right.
Feed it back or feed it up to something like a CCM or some other, you know, higher level management software product that might, you know, I'm sure they will build hooks into that, into SCCM, and let DSC be like the underlying platform technology.
How many people use that, but it was one of the big things that a lot of the community even said about DSC, is there reporting capability. So it would not surprise me with some of the, obviously it just came out today, V5, the framework with
Windows Management Framework, the V5 preview.
Never finish yet.
not surprise me if even in some of like the release packs and stuff like that.
Can we please go get it? Yeah, sure, why not? So right before our meeting, I just couldn't resist. I installed the version 5 preview of the Windows Management Framework. So this is PowerShell V5 preview. And I think, yeah, I haven't even had a chance to look at it, but one of the things that TJ was saying was that they have this one get module, which, you know, has some commandlets built in, and this is essentially a package manager, the missing package manager, if you will, for PowerShell. So, and I don't think that one get is quite a package manager per se, but it will provide hooks into other package management systems. So out of the box, the only one currently supported is NuGet. If anybody's familiar with NuGet, you know, my understanding of NuGet is that it is a, or I should say Chocolaty, you know, which is like the Windows focused version of, you know, like the NuGet package management solution. So this is essentially going out, I think, and showing us what all packages are available to install via Chocolaty. So I could install, I guess, any one of these. I could install install package mremote, no tab completion there, mremote ng. This will install mremote from an untrusted source. Yeah, sure, why not? So this is, I mean, this brings up a very interesting topic for me. If you're at all security minded, you have to take into consideration that you're using a open source repository of hosting executable code that you're then invoking and allowing to install on your box, which doesn't sound safe at all. It's got to be good. It's got to be good. So, mremote ng, right? I don't know. Did that add it to my path? Mremote ng. Mremote. There it is. I did not have that installed. I did have that installed before. Yeah, I moved over to RoyalTS. I don't know if you guys use that. It's a paid version. The developer of mremote. Mremote is free, but I think development has ceased on it. I'm not. RoyalTS is not free. I think they have a trial, but I think you're limited to the number of concurrent sessions that you can have at any given time. RDC man, yeah. Yeah, I used to use that too. RoyalTS does VNC, SSH, web pages, custom executable code. It's pretty nice. It'll look at your hyper, if you have Hyper-V instance running on your client and you launch it with admin privilege, it'll show you all your guest VM instances and you can connect to them with enhanced session mode support and all that stuff. Whereas RDC man is just RDP. Yeah. But that's pretty. So let's pick something else that I didn't already have. What other packages do we have? Or is this looking at stuff that I've already installed? Find package. I think I already have. I think this hand break. Yeah, I already have it. My cat. So. Any help for this? I guess this would be faster.
Is this your color display?
Yeah, this is. You mean the console?
Yeah, or was it coming from Windows Management Framework 5?
No, this is a Kanemu, which is this guy here. It's a free and open source console emulator program. that is the number one thing that I dislike about the old school command.exe is the lack of automatic resizing of your window. It's 2014. I think we all deserve a better prompt. But it has an insane amount of, if you go into settings.
Is it a black background with white text?
No, this is the, so if you go under colors or themes, so this is Solarized, which is a built-in theme here, but they have other themes that you can pick, like traditional PowerShell. You can go darker.
I knew it wasn't the original blue.
No, and you can define... yes. Is it 8? Okay. Should probably probably pack up. So, yeah, it's free. I believe it's open source, but it's actually pretty nice and has an insane amount of bells and whistles on it.
You really use just the console by itself that
often? I kind of do what Ashley said. I use the console as like a so some of the problems that I experience when I develop in the I love the ISC and I use it to script, but there's this beauty of having the separation between your current variable state being separate in a console host versus in your ISC only, because you start to develop things and you start to work on things and then you start to get values out of variables that you already pre-populated, and then you take that as an assumption that that's what you're going to expect, and then you go run that, you know, in a host that doesn't have those predefined variables, and you're stuck, or you find that your code breaks. So I like to kind of model things in the prompt in like a separate shell instance, and then when I get stuff that I need to, you know, that I need to use, and I usually launch my console host as under admin so that I can work with like the client side of Hyper-V stuff. So if I need to stop a VM or start a bunch of, you know, lab VMs that are running locally, I can do that. Because all those commandlets require elevated privilege. But I think, unfortunately, we're out of time. Yep. Kind of jumped around. So yeah, Windows Management Framework 5. I don't know if there's a particular, when it will be, will it be released as part of the update 1?
I think he said something like next week.
Next week? So, okay.
That's what he said.
Preview.
Because I don't know if it's coming out with update 1 or not. I think update 1.
Question for you about that one. It's like, will not affect on some kind of either some kind of GPU, like an NVIDIA?
Will it affect CPU?
Yeah, I know. I affect on the regulation when you change that. But I don't know if the regulation will not affect on that one.
Like in the console? You can do control. Oh man, what did I bind that to something else? I think you can. I thought you could change the size of the text relative in the console host, but maybe that's not the case.
I mean, it's like if you put the NVIDIA driver in, mm-hmm. you would take over the window, and then maybe you see the layer is completely different.
Okay.
Yeah, and then I'm not sure this emulation software is based on the window or based on the...
Oh, that I don't know. Yeah.
But when you do it, it's different than the console.
Okay.
I'm not sure everything. The way I look at that was, I go to the console,
uh-huh.
and then I do the setup, the resolution, I give you two options, one window and one entity, you can, what I want to choose.
Oh, okay.
And when I choose that one, and if you like that driver, and then they give you different stories.
Okay.
Yeah, they put the landscape thing, but not the normal. And then you have some thing. They put portrait, and then they go like this.
Okay. Yeah, I'm not familiar with that at all. There is something cool that I just found that I'll tell you guys about. If you just want to stick with, let me see. So where is it? This guy, Roman Kuzman, wrote this amazing little function called Resize Console Window.
Yeah.
So if you're in a regular command.exe, you know, console host session, let me see. PowerShell. could do, and I can use the arrow keys to dynamically resize like a normal console host, and it's essentially just manipulating the properties of the layout. So if you're I aliased it to RCW, but this is called resize console window. I have the link here on, essentially he just replied to somebody who was asking like, how do I do this? And he just gave that Perl in like a comment reply. And I think it was pretty much ready to go, and I just put it into a function and stuffed it in my profile. Says my connection has been lost. But yeah, that's it, guys. I don't want to go too far over. Thank you very much. You want? Yeah, you guys want to do a quick giveaway?
No. I should just get to something else. So, starting over there, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
And what am I doing here? I'm doing.
Get random.
1 to 7. Pipe that to get random. Count 1, right? So that's 7. The second one's 4.
Seven is that
gentleman?
Oh, I know we got other stuff, actually.
Oh, we got more stuff?
Yeah, if you give me your email address, I'll send you a voucher for a free book at O'Reilly.
Okay.
You, over here, where we have left, though.
All right,
so.
Hey, Ashley, you still there? Ashley.
Don't put me in a giveaway, man.
No, I was just checking to see if you were still there. I was gonna say sign off and say goodbye.
Oh, okay. All right, yeah, it was good sharing the evening with you guys. It's a lot of fun. Glad you guys are having a good group there, and wish you all the best. We'll see you online.
Yeah, man, thanks a lot.
All right, thanks. Take care.
Yep, have a good one.
You too.